generally dry day on Wednesday with sunny periods.
Okay, I've got a lychee farm here in Tyrone, which is just west of Gingin. Also, we've got a back Springfield farm. It was a cane farm. It's going into macadamias.
However, there may be more cloud in the south.
I'd certainly call it a boom. I'd probably even go as far as calling it a once-in-a-generational boom.
Where it will be breezier. After a chilly start, it will be mostly dry on Thursday.
There isn't too many Murrumpaa farmers left anymore because the cost of doing business is too high.
They're millions of dollars in debt. They're doing it harder than everybody else, the big farmers.
However, it may be rather cloudy in the southeast. Patchy rain will arrive.
The big people want to rule, the little people don't matter.
But at the end of the day, a rising tide floats all ships.
On FM, on long wave, on digital radio and online.
If you're a smaller farmer, you'd find it very hard to survive. We first started with one farm years ago, then we bought the neighbour. So over 25 years, we've basically bought out 25 different farmers just to become viable. There's very few young people coming into the ag industry, which you really couldn't afford to get into the industry unless you're actually born in it now. In Bundy, the price of land's roughly between $10,000 to $25,000 an acre, which means if it's a good farm, you're up to for $2 million before you got a house, before you buy your tractors, and then before you buy seed. No one realises the total cost on doing business. If you got 100 people out there in the paddock, it's $3,000 an hour. Everyone wants us to do it better, pay more money to people, but if there's no money to pay, you can't do it, you know what I mean? We've got these three products here. They do 40 hectares of spray, which is 100 acres, which is a fair bit, $5,000. $5,000. I think that's 5,000 something dollars. $80,000 in this bin. This two machines here cost just around the $500,000 to buy those. Both those components there. Yeah, it's got to be numbers, yeah. You've got to put out big volumes to make any money because it's only a couple of dollars a box profit, if a profit. We're lucky that the prices have gone up because that's the only reason I think a lot of us are still here is because our values are going up, then you can lend against your value. Outside investment companies have come and actually look because we got the only parcel left of a couple thousand acres in one spot. I personally don't know where all the money's coming from, but there's some mass amount of money being put into Bundy, and a lot of it's investment money. It's all secured income, but nothing's guaranteed.
This is April 2003. There would be quite a few landholders in there. It's gone from being pretty much all cane land to only that bit there and those bits up there and a few bits in, through there that are still used for cropping.
Up until about 2012, the rural land index sat at about 6.3%. Compare that to what we've seen in the last 10 years where there's been 100 to 300% increases in some asset classes. In my view, at least, it's a level of growth that would only be observed once in a lifetime.
The boom's been created by cheap money, low interest rates, really strong commodity prices in some ag sectors, or quite a few ag sectors. Institutional investment at a capacity that we probably haven't seen before. Those who have been able to expand have obviously done that.
They're old photos, of course. Mum was 18 and the middle one's 21 for Dad before he went to war, and the one on the right's when he came home from war. He was about nearly 25 there. If Dad was still alive, he'd be 103, actually tomorrow.
Well, I've been living here for 53 years, on and off. on and off for 53 years. Was cane from here to town. There was, might have been the odd block of pumpkins growing, maybe a few melons, but very rarely. It was all sugar cane. The families have moved off. The young ones have moved off. There's not too many young people more or less going from generation to generation on the farm. Some are, not too many. A lot of the farms are sold on.
So who?
Well, in today's world, investors, they come in and they buy the farm. They don't want a farm. They want to buy the farm and then resell it in a couple of years, make big profit. Well, I had cancer and I made a rash decision and I sold the farm. I shouldn't have done that. You make these decisions, we think it's a good idea at the time. Sell the property, the farm got a lot less than what it's worth today, but at the time it was a good price. The big people want to rule, the little people don't matter. Councils will tell you they'd rather deal with two or three big fellas than 200 farmers.
People sit there and say, oh, I'm a bit concerned about foreign investment or we're losing control of the farms. But at the end of the day, a rising tide floats all ships. Farmland and resources are becoming more scarce. We're seeing associated with that new investors globally are coming into the market. Foreign investment has helped increase the output, the productivity, the access to markets, and obviously land values, and farmers in Australia has been a big benefactor of that. The upsides of operating as a larger scale agribusiness are obviously around efficiencies, how you manage your costs, how you farm, how you adapt technology, and creating more margin for your product. As this consolidation occurs, there's going to be a balancing act between the big getting bigger and the big getting too big, and what impact that's going to have on the smaller farmer.
This is my cherry picker. This bit of land is me. It's my farm. What I grow in it is what my ancestors, they grew in the past. And I sell all this stuff at the markets, no contracts at all. Like me, I'm Italian, my wife is Filipina, putting the ideas together and this is what we got. Everything I do is me and my wife and my kids.
Thank you so much. Have a good day.
If I say, get a heart attack tomorrow, this is owned by my wife or my kids. Not like these other blokes, they can't talk because they're millions of dollars in debt. They're doing it harder than everybody else, the big farmers. They just keep rolling it over and over and over. That's all they do. But I can't live that way. Eventually, little pocket farmers like this, they won't exist because, well, there won't be no people owning land anyway.
This is some pumpkin that's been just left behind just because of poor pricing. That pumpkin in the supermarket would probably retail for $24. Really, at the end of the day, when we put it into the market, after freight and picking and packing, we'd probably get 60 cents. These pumpkins here are sitting here because it'd cost us more to pick, pack and send than we'd actually get back out of it. So it may as well stay here. At $15,000 an acre, just drop the shit on the ground. Personally, I think everyone in the industry is actually tired. I personally don't sleep. I got my eyes shut, but I wake up in the morning, I've worked problems out overnight, and I don't sleep. We're at the stage now, we're not going no bigger. We're it, that's it. If anything, probably getting smaller. Yeah, or get out.
You mean if I had the chance again? Definitely not. Never sell it. You learn a lot. And real estate agents and people in business, they will not tell you the pitfalls. You either learn them or you know them or you get walked over.
I guess the final thing is you don't see many large amounts of farms and things like that boarding an aeroplane to go back overseas. The asset stays here. We've got a legal system around the ownership of that asset.
I will never be rich. I'll never be a millionaire doing this. We live, and we live healthy.